3 years ago, so I was Timmy when I was at Lawrence. So I don't recognize you if you, it's been 40 years. So I'm sure there are people here that, I mean, I know Tom and a few others. This morning I wrote in my journal, and so I wanted to read it to you. I can count on one hand the number of people. Okay, I'm sorry. I just had lunch with my sister, and you know how those country meals are. So I'll try to get through this. The number of people that have truly impacted me so much that it actually changed the direction of my life and my destiny. I was a kid from a little struggling tobacco farm. My uneducated parents didn't have the ability to give me direction for my life, other than the things they already knew from their cobbled together small lives. And art and abstract thinking was a big stretch from taking care of cows. My love was art. I didn't understand anything about it, other than I knew I had a gift. I certainly didn't know what to do with it. So my high school art teacher was Miss Snavely, and she saw a tiny spark, and in her gentle way, she began to fan it, and she encouraged me. I didn't realize it at the time, but in order to broaden my world, she drove me all the way to Columbia to tour the art school at USC. That's probably why she was teacher of the year that you spoke about earlier. Unfortunately, my SAT scores were not high enough to get into USC. So I gave up on that dream until a day I'll never forget. Little did I know, was in the background working to get me into a program called Opportunity Scholars. It was a program at USC designed for students that showed high potential or for students that were better at football than they were academics. There were a lot of football players in my Opportunity Scholar class. Out of the blue, I got a letter from the admissions office at USC that invited me to enroll. At that point, I had no idea that it was Miss Snavely fanning the flame once again. She never called to say, "Look what I did for you." She quietly just watched and then allowed others to fan the flame she had nurtured. I became a graphic designer, art director, creative director, artist, consultant, and business owner, all because Miss Snavely saw something and gently guided my life into an uncharted path. It was around 2003. I had my first solo art exhibition at the largest privately owned gallery in South Carolina. She called to say she was going to make the drive to Columbia to see it. "Don't tell my family," she said. "They don't think I should be driving long trips anymore. So I'm going to keep that secret." After giving her a tour of the exhibition, I took her to lunch at the Blue Marble. We sat outside in the sunshine and reminisced about my time in high school. I reached over and took her hand. "You know, this exhibit would never have happened had you not been in my life." I told her how grateful I was for everything she did for me. Oh. also had conversations about faith as she encouraged my spiritual life. And I read these verses this morning from the Message Bible that reminded me of her awesome encouragement. Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians 5, 9 through 11 from the Message. God didn't set us up for an angry rejection, but for salvation by our Master, Jesus Christ. He died for us, a death that triggered life. Whether we're awake with the living or asleep with the dead, we're alive in Him. So speak encouraging words to one another. Build up hope so that you'll all be together in this. No one left out. No one left behind. I know you're already doing this. Just keep doing it. You know, the fire of creativity burns brightly in me today, and the reason is a beautiful lady named Lois Anita Mouse, namely, quietly and sometimes secretly, nurtured a tiny spark until this farm boy had a future that looked much different than the destiny of his past.
I don't know that I could do this without crying. If you've known me for a long time, and I don't cry easy. But when I came to Morris, I had a guardian angel. And her name was Lois Snagley. And her wings were so big, they completely surrounded you. We did so many things together. We did education together. We laughed together. And one of the things, she knew a secret that I was colorblind. And one day, we're living in, where were we living in that room of furniture? Or Woodruff. We were living in Woodruff.
Oh, when you got that.
And I had all of the furniture recolored in orange. And Alvin made me keep it until we moved to Clemson. It was the only place that was acceptable.
It was awful.
But Lois knew this. So after leasing the house from Mildred and Noel, we were getting ready to redo the house. And Alfie was away, and he said, call Lois. Don't do anything with color until you call Lois. So Lois and I went down to look at material. We went all around looking at material. And she began to realize that she loved bright colors. And you had to be careful what color you suggested to me. It couldn't be orange, and it couldn't be purple. So she said, let's paint all the walls yellow. We did that. Then she said, oh, do you like this flower? It was an Indian print with gorgeous flowers and paisleys and things. And she said, this is what your drapes and your bedspreads and your dust ruffles and your shower curtains. Every room in my house has the same thing. Because only Lois knew that would work for me. So I called out and I said, well, we're going to do this, this, and this. And he said, what? I said, Lois approved it. Oh, all right. I have the most gorgeous house in town. And in every room in my house is Lois. She's there every day. And every morning when I get up in the morning, or every night when I go to bed, she did a quilt for me. And it was done in blue and white and yellow. To borrow Muriel's words, when I called Muriel to tell her that she was not here with us anymore, she said, Caroline, she opened the world to me. Well, she shared my world and expanded it 1,000 times. We did Girl Scouts together. And I've been a Girl Scout for over 65 years. She was the first Girl Scout I had ever met that was on foreign soil like I was. And we would talk about how the Girl Guides did things and how they do them in different countries. And Sandy Padgett and myself and Rosemary, I'll think of the other person in a minute. We had a Girl Scout trip. And Lois always came for Founders Day. And we loved scouting. We always did projects. And one day she was going through my house and she said, what are these? I said, oh, that's a box of stamps. If you're ever card worthy, you get a card from me that's hand done. Lois washed all those stamps from the mildew. But she'd say, you're not stamping enough. You're not doing this enough. And after she retired, yes, she did develop her talent of quilting. And I was lucky enough to have learned to quilt with Maria, and we would quilt. She would use the machine to put to the top. I was hand stitching away. And finally she'd say, I'll do the machine for you if you'll hand quilt, because that was my first love. And she just had so many wonderful things. You learn something new every day with Lois. Whether it was a book you'd read the night before, and I'd call her and I'd say, you gotta go read this. So we'd run over to the library and she'd read it. We'd sit down and talk for hours about it. She had wings and a halo. And her favorite words were, let's go. One day she called me up and she said, what are you doing? And I said, well, I have a list of things to do today. And she said, pack a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And we went to Columbia. And we went to see a marveling exposition. Well, later time passes and I decide, well, I'm going to do something with the Girl Scouts. I'm going to do a national, international program. I had 50 children here, one from each of the states. And we get a low country tours, Georgetown, Savannah, and Charleston. Who do you think was with me every day? Coastal said, I only hired you. I said, well, we've got two of us. We ran those people wild and the girls wild. But when they left, they got a credit for art, they got a credit for history, and they got a credit because opera was always playing. And the superintendents of those schools looked at us and they said, where did you get this curriculum? Lois Stanger did. She was always saying to me, Caroline, quit messing with Alton. Let him be there. If he was in the hospital and I would want him to be home or do something, she said, let him be. Ernie will come over. And they did come over. They used our house and I used her house. We both shared houses for years. They'd sneak up the steps at night. The children were all home who had become my sisters and brothers and dear children. And they would give their house to them and they'd come over to my house. And I tried, like Santa Claus coming every year, to see them sneak up the steps. Can you imagine Ernie with a stocking cap and a candle and a nightshirt? And Lois behind him sneaking up the steps? I never caught them. Never could I catch them. But they were wonderful, wonderful people. When it came time to do the puppets, Lois used to say, that dress is just a little bit outdated. Let's make one. She'd go to her stash of material, pull out a piece that was just right, and zip up a dress for me for this puppet. So many things we did, so many things we did. We went on a trip, and Wolf, my son, decided whom he loved his neighbors, so he called them grandparents. And he got us hotel rooms before and after the cruise. And she said, oh, we don't need it. Now, by that time, Lois was much older than I was, but she also, I couldn't go 24 hours a day like I used to. And she said, but we're not going to sleep. You know, children take a nap. No, we're not sleeping. We sat in the bed the day before and the day after the cruise waiting, talking about all that we've done. If she just had an energy. And you talk about her smile. The last time I saw Lois, she didn't say a word. She couldn't remember my name, but she knew who I was. The smile on her face. So she has given me a protection. And I know she's in heaven waiting for all of us to join her. Because she used to say, I'll see you again. I'll see you again. And can you imagine the conversation between Ernie and Lois? Honey, I'll be right back. I'm just going over to Peru. There's something I didn't see. What a gift she was for everyone in this room, for everyone in this church, and for this community. And she did. She opened the world in so many ways. And the last thing I'll leave you with, do you remember seeing this church with the pumpkins? Hundreds of pumpkins out there. Hundreds and hundreds of pumpkins. And I thought, what am I going to do with all these pumpkins? Lois said, we're going to cook them. And we're going to make pumpkin pies for Christmas and Thanksgiving and birthdays. But I learned to do all the things that she was giving to us and how she gave it to us. Goodbye, dear friend. I will miss you and I'll miss your protection. I'll miss your love. But most of all,